We've wrapped up round one of the 2020 NFL Draft. I'm Sierra Goodwill here with Evan Lazar and Mike Petralia. Now, the New England faithful might be a little disappointed because we have no Patriots picks to discuss in our round one wrap up, but there were some exciting moves, namely number 5 pick, Miami Dolphins choosing Tua Tagovailoa, taking a chance on who knows what could be his severity level of his injury moving forward. But obviously, the potential for greatness is extremely high. Other than Tua, what moves really stood out to you in day one?
Well, I think that what we saw was is all that kind of murmurs about the board being kind of up in the air for a lot of teams because of a lack of consensus this year with no pro days and all that traveling for scouts. Now everybody's locked up in their own homes and they don't really have everybody as sounding boards to kind of sort out these prospects. So we saw some just weird reaches, I thought, in the first round, especially at the end of the first round. Damon Arnett from Ohio State to the Raiders was kind of the first one. Listen, I think Arnett has got really good tape, but he ran in the 4.5s in the 40-yard dash at the combine and just is a guy that has some real issues staying in phase long speed down the field. Guys that are burners, which ironically the Raiders took the best one in Henry Ruggs a few picks earlier, those guys give Arnett a little bit of issues. He's a rider, you know, he's just going to ride a guy all the way down the field and be physical with him, but the guys that are looser and quicker and faster give him some issues. I thought he was more of a day two guy. The other guy that was just absolutely shocking was Jordan Brooks for Seattle over Patrick Queen, who got picked by the next pick by Baltimore. Jordan Brooks is a guy that I had as a third round pick, a fringe top 100 guy. Obviously, Seattle just loves his fit in the system. That has to be the explanation. He's a read and react linebacker, good kind of ability to move side to side laterally to be able to jump gap to gap to match running backs, but definitely not a guy that I penciled in as a first round pick.
My eyes were on a couple of things. First of all, what the Miami Dolphins did, not for next year, but I think for the years going forward. I think next year, not just because of what's going on right now with the quarantine and who knows when the 2020 season will begin with all of the uncertainty around the upcoming year in the NFL, but the 2021 season is what I think Chris Greer, the general manager down in Miami, and obviously Brian Flores, the head coach, are building for. Tua Tagovailoa and Austin Jackson, the 20-year-old tackle out of USC, first team, all Pac-12. I think those were two moves made by the Dolphins to show the rest of the AFC East. Unlike the Jets, I think, of a couple of years ago with Sam Darnold, we're not thinking about next year. We're thinking about the year after and after that. And I think that struck me as interesting in a division that no longer has Tom Brady in it. The other part that I wanted to bring up was the fact that, and it was ironic because one of our videos on Thursday night, I brought up the fact there had been no trades in the, you know, first 12 picks or so. Sure enough, right after that, it was Tampa Bay and San Francisco executing a swap at 13 and 14. And Nick Caserio brought that up on Thursday night in his conference call after the draft was over and after the first round was over. And he said that essentially it looked like the rest of the NFL was trying to wait and see up in the first 10 picks whether or not there were any hiccups with what was happening in the virtual draft. Once all of the teams were kind of felt self-assured that everything would go off smoothly, you started to see a few more trades come down the pike, obviously, including the Patriots swapping with the LA Chargers.
I was disappointed in the Miami Dolphins. The Dolphins, they come out, they draft Tua. That's a great pick. But then Austin Jackson and Noah I from Auburn, I'm not going to try to pronounce his last name. Those are two big-time reaches in the first round for them. And I was disappointed because they started off the draft on a really good note with Tua. And those two guys were more day two, day three type guys. But the Minnesota Vikings, hats off to them. They had a great draft. They draft Justin Jefferson and Jeff Gladney both in later on in the first round. Those are two major steals at both of those spots. So good ups for them. They had a great round.
And I also thought that one thing that was interesting in the first round of the draft, there was a lot of talk about how deep this draft is at wide receiver. CeeDee Lamb, unquestionably, probably the number one prospect at his position, the third wide receiver drafted. He's going to Dallas to play for the Cowboys. But I thought it was interesting that Henry Ruggs was the first wide out off the board in this draft. Still a couple names that we've discussed previously as possible Patriots prospects on the board, like Denzel Mims at the wide receiver position, Cole Kmet at tight end. You mentioned Zach Bond at linebacker in a previous position we did last night. Guys, give me a couple names of guys that you were shocked fell out of the first round and would be steals at the top of the second.
Well, I think Josh Jones from Houston, apparently there might be a medical red flag. I have to do some more homework on that. That might be why he fell out of the first round. He was my tackle five in this draft, and you see two tackles go ahead of him in Austin Jackson and Isaiah Wilson. So obviously something has to be up there. I'm also pretty shocked that Xavier McKinney made it out of the first round. I know he had the bad combine, but when you turn on the tape with that guy, he's all over the field. He plays every position you could possibly think of, the defensive backfield, deep safety, split safety coverages, man coverage down in the box, linebacker, edge rusher even sometimes. So he's kind of that do-it-all type Swiss Army guy. I didn't really see him coming out of the first round either. So those two guys getting out of the first round, I think, are the top two guys on my board, and pretty shocking that they're still there.
How about AJ Epenesa?
I was pretty shocked about Epenesa too, but the combine really did kill him. And he's a guy that you're going to want to play closer to either at the tackle or outside of the tackle for a lot of systems, like a 4-3 end. He's going to be playing outside that tackle spot. And his inability to really change direction or run down the line is going to be something that a lot of teams are going to be concerned about. That backside pursuit is a very important job at that kind of scheme and that kind of position. So the fact that he only ran what he did, and he's kind of a plotter on tape too. You can see some of the stiffness also when you watch him on film. So I think that teams were just a little bit reluctant to take him just at that point in time, given the value.
I'll bring up the coach, though, just to beware, Kirk Ferentz. And you know Bill Belichick and Kirk Ferentz have a very, very tight relationship. And I think that is a possibility if he falls all the way to 37 for the Patriots, given what they have as needs on the outside.
Absolutely.
We'll have you covered all day on Friday and Saturday on our website at clnsmedia.com. And we'll be going live periodically throughout the draft on our website, on our YouTube channel at CLNS Media. So be sure to check it out.